is Huruma. Good morning, Crosswalk. Are we here today? Let me know if you're here. All right. Hey, thanks so much for coming. I'm glad you got the memo that we are inside today, and we got a good one for you. Before we get rolling on all the Furaha stuff, I'll clue you in on that in just a few moments. But if this is your first time to Crosswalk, we welcome you. We're our own kind of weird collection of Jesus followers here, but we do a whole lot of good stuff here in Napa and the world, and we're glad you're here, and you're going to hear a lot about us today, about what we're doing in Africa. So today's sole focus is just on that. So you're going to get a lot about that. It's one of many things that are near and dear to our hearts. We do a whole lot of food ministry here in Napa for our community, and this is a whopper that we do overseas. We served about 120,000 meals over the last 12 months for these kids that you're going to hear about, which is just awesome. So if you're new, please register your attendance so we can thank you for coming today. And we have a gift bag for you if you're brand new and want a little bit more information about us. Also, we have a couple things back there on the table on your way out. We always have free Bibles, so if you don't have a Bible that's easy to read, then grab one of those free of charge. That's on us. And we have a couple books that we sell to help you get to know our feel, our ethos, our theology here. One has to do with how do you think about the Bible, and the other has to do strictly with theology. So each of those are $10. That's cheaper than you can get them anywhere else. So grab one of those. Good reading, and I think you'll enjoy that. Okay, so today, what we're after. We're going to talk to you about an amazing experience that we just had just a few weeks ago with a team that's going to make their way to the stage in a few moments. But what you have before you in this set, I want you to see what we have here. Each year we try to do something different when we come back. This would be a typical home in the slum of Huruma. And where you would probably enter, see if I got this right, would probably be like the door here, guys. Is that about right? So you would come into this room, and the actual scale is about 8 by 8. And you'd come in, and it's extremely tight. So the edge of the carpet here, that's really the edge of the room. And what's going to be right here, if you come into this space, is a curtain. You're not going to be able to see past this curtain. And behind that curtain, there's going to be a bed and everything else that the family of 4 to 6 to 8 people who are living in this place own. And that's it. So you come in here, and this actually is pretty roomy because when we would come do a home visit, which we'll describe, it's literally, you know, getting around like this because everything is so crammed into this space. The other thing that you see here is you see pots and pans, you see some sort of a coffee table kind of a thing. Couch is pretty standard over there because somebody's going to sleep on it. Of course, you're going to sit on it. But this is your room for living. This is your room for reading. This is your room for doing your homework. And this is your kitchen. Everything is right here. So just imagine you come home from work and your child from Furaha is there along with maybe 2 or 3 other children that you're caring for at Furaha Community Center are here too. And somehow you're all going to find room in this space and you're going to be able to cook a meal at the same time. And if it was like when we visited, which was the rainy season, you don't really want to go outside because it's just knee-deep muck everywhere you go. And you don't want any of that out there to come in here. So you're crammed in this little space. This is actually, the team did a great job. There would be little touches in the each home that would let you know a little bit about the family. We're missing a teddy bear up here because that wasn't... Oh, there is a teddy bear? Oh, there it is. All right, so it wouldn't be uncommon to have a kid's toy or a kid's teddy bear somewhere sitting around. So you know you're in a home. It would not be uncommon to see a calendar on the wall. It would not be uncommon to see a photo or a picture of something that they valued. So they're like us in that way. Our homes reflect our values and what we think. But what's very different about this space up here is that you can see me clearly. It's bright. You go into a home in Huruma, it is about as dark as you can get. And it's dark because there aren't windows in the place. The only light that comes in is going to be through the cracks in the door. If there is a window on the door, which is very uncommon, it's completely covered. You know why it's completely covered? Because nobody in here wants anybody out there to see inside, because they might see something they want, and they might just come in and get it. And so it's as dark as you can imagine. So when folks like us come into a space like this, we have no idea where we're sitting, what we're sitting on, what things are really like, except for when that door opens up. Every person that we spoke to, and each team went around to probably 6 or 8 homes, very much like this. We start in the high rent district, which means that you're on a floor of an apartment, perhaps, and you may be on a floor with maybe 8 or 10 other apartment buildings in a cinder block unit, much like the one that collapsed that we've talked about. And all of you together, figure 6 to 8 in each one of these homes, you're sharing one toilet for the entire floor, and you're sharing one spigot for water for the entire floor. So that's your life. Electricity is shoddy. If you're in one of the lower rent districts, you're pirating your electricity because you can't afford a real connection. And that means that it's dangerous. When we were walking around the slums, especially since it was wet, our bodyguards and leaders of Furaha who are with us, I make it sound more dangerous than it may be, because in Huruma they know who we are and they value us. And so we never really felt threatened at all in the slums. Would you agree? Yeah, very safe. But anyway, our guides would tell us, don't touch the tin roofs that were in the lower rent district, was the roof of some of these shanties. Because if the electricity is pirated and they didn't know what they were doing, you're just not sure what's hot. Wasn't uncommon for some of these homes to burn to the ground because of shoddy electrical work. So this is home. And our team is going to come up and share some things with you in a few moments. But first, I want to whet your appetite. Her name is Josephine. And Josephine, her role with Furaha Community Foundation in the slum of Huruma outside of Nairobi, Kenya, she works with the social services aspect of Furaha. Furaha is a comprehensive thing. It's not just a school. It's primarily a school. But for the parents and the guardians of the children of Furaha, we also are part of a microfinance organization. So these people can start a new business and pay a loan back, which we have an amazing success rate with. So they can sell and make and sell chapatis, which is our communion bread today. So you're going to eat what they eat on a good day. They might have a vegetable stand. They might have what we would call a restaurant. They call it a hotel. Any manner of things you can imagine, there's all these little micro businesses. That's part of what Furaha does and its oversight. Another thing that it does is in its holistic care of the students, Josephine makes her rounds every day to visit the homes of the students because she wants to make sure that the environment for the students are as good as they can be. And if there are any red flags that they come across, any health concerns, Furaha wants to know about it. If there's been hardship, Furaha wants to know about it so that they can step in and help with their community. So Josephine, that's her world. That's her experience. She would always be the first one. If we were getting ahead of ourselves or if she felt like we were moving into the day too quickly, us Westerners tend to do that, she would stop everything, which is cool because she's a she in a patriarchal society. Full of life, Josephine would stop us and say, I think we need to pray. So she would be our prayer cup every morning. And she would insist that we did, and she would remind us why. She would say, when you start your day with prayer, you open yourself up to the presence of God, that God might actually speak to you. And when you don't, you just might not. And you might miss everything that God would have for you. So she would correct our priorities through the day. And more often than not, she would have us sing a song also. And the song, the lyrics of which are in your flyer. It's a very simple song, and it's right toward the top on the front page, "How Excellent Is Your Name." And I'm going to sing it through for you once, and then I'm going to invite you to sing the second and the third verse. And this is how the song would go, and then I want to just have you let this tweak your brain a little bit. But this is how the song goes. I think it's probably an old chorus that started somewhere in the West. "How excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name. How excellent is your name. How excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name. How excellent is your name. How excellent is your name, O Lord." Now, every time we'd sing that, I was troubled, and I'm still troubled. And the reason I'm troubled is because I look at the lyrics, and it all seems to be saying good things to and about God. God is excellent. The second verse we would often do is, "How beautiful is your name?" And then, "How powerful is your name?" And the reason it troubled me is because I know where Josephine's been that day. And I know where she's going to go the next day, and the next day, and the next day. She's going to go to home something like this. And one of the worst slums in the world, literally. And yet, without any falsehood, without putting on airs, but with genuine, true passion, she's singing, "How excellent is your name, O God," or "O Lord." I'm wondering, how in the world can somebody who lives in this environment sing praises to God? It messes with me. It still messes with me. And I wonder if it's messing with you. In my experience, especially in the Western world, we get mad at God if we stub our toe. How did you let that happen, God? Or if something happens with our health, how did you let that happen, God? Why are you doing this to me? Or if somebody we love dies, why did you let that happen, God? Or if we lose our job, why did you let that happen, God? If you missed the stoplight, why did you let that happen, God? I think we're really good the other way of criticizing God when things don't go well. And I think that's why this song, sung and led by Josephine, messes with me so much. Because where they live, you cannot find anywhere near that or at that scale, especially at that scale, anywhere in the United States. You can't find it. It's just not like that here. How in the world can she sing that? And that's my cliffhanger for you this morning. You're going to get to sing this song later, but now I just wanted to mess with you. So I want to invite the team up who was there to check all this out and give you their experience. We have two teenagers with us. We have Lake and Shaw, my daughter, and Isabella Corley, and Stephen Corley. Isabella is Stephen's niece who is able to go with us, and Isabella's, some of her family's here anyway, which is very exciting to have you here. So we're going to hand it over to them for the next chunk of the service, and you're going to get to hear their story. So let's welcome our Furaha team.
All right, so for my presentation, I want to introduce you to three students I met during the trip that really impacted me. So the first one is Brandon, and he's about a kindergartner at the primary school. So about halfway through the week, me and my team went with Josephine to visit the guardians of some of the homes. And we started on the main path, and the houses were kind of like this. And then we got closer and closer to the river, and the houses got worse and worse. And so we go inside this one house, and I meet the mother, and she has a baby. And we start asking her questions about, you know, how much money do you make? What do you do? How many kids do you have? And then we notice that there's this little boy, this kindergartner, in the corner. And she said she has 4 kids and 3 in school, so it didn't make sense. So we asked, why isn't he in school? She said, well, it was raining last night. And so soon enough, we realized that right outside their front door, there's a stream of open sewage. And when it rains, it overflows and comes into their house. And Brandon's uniform was on the ground, and it got ruined. And because she had to work to provide for her family, since the father isn't in the picture, she couldn't go to the school and explain why he couldn't wear his uniform, so he had to stay home. And for me, that was just, that broke my heart, because that's a little boy who really, really wants to go to school. And we don't see that here in the United States. Kids don't really want to go to school that much, but Brandon really did, and he couldn't because of where he lived. And that was just really hard for me. So the next student I met was at the high school. His name is Alex, and he was the class president. And I first met him when he was demonstrating a physics lab for me. And I immediately noticed he was super smart. He was doing this lab with complex circuits and resistors, and he just explained it so well. And then we asked him what he wanted to be when he grew up, and he wants to be a spinal surgeon. That's pretty awesome. So I immediately knew he was super smart. So then, about an hour later, we're sitting at an assembly with all the students, and I'm sitting between 2 girls, and we're talking. And then the girl to my left gets up because she's going to be part of the dancing group. They're going to perform for us. And so Alex, who was sitting behind me, taps me on the shoulder, says, hey, can I come sit up next to you? I want to ask you some questions. And I didn't really find that surprising, because I noticed a lot of the kids like to ask questions about my house, my school. So I said, yeah, sure, come up, sit next to me. And so he gets next to me, and he's smiling, and then he says, okay, now I have to think of some questions to ask you. So throughout the assembly, we're talking. He's coming up with questions as we go. And then towards the end, Gilbert, who's the director of When I Grow Up, goes to the front of all the students. And he was there the previous week, so he had seen them. And when he was there earlier, he gave them a quote that I'll read for you in a second. And he said, okay, whoever can figure out which president said this quote, I'll give you a prize. And it turns out Alex was the one who figured out who said the quote. So he gets to go up there, and Gilbert says, okay, so for your prize, I want to ask your principal if you can have 2 days off of doing your chores. And the high school students, they wake up at 4:30 a.m. every morning, and they do chores. So Gilbert wanted to give Alex a break from that. He said, Alex, how does that sound? And Alex is shaking his head, says no. And his principal ended up not letting him do that anyway, so Stephen gave him his fleece sweatshirt. But what I found really interesting was Alex wasn't shaking his head and saying no because he knew his principal wasn't going to go for it. He didn't want it. He didn't want a break from his chores, because if he wasn't doing it, that meant someone else would be doing more work. And that was really cool for me, because that kind of represents all of the high schoolers there, where they really care about each other, and they all want to work together to help each other succeed. So that was really cool. So I'm going to read you the quote. Okay, this is by Theodore Roosevelt. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming. But who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. So later on, Gilbert asked Alex how he found that quote, because they don't have internet there, so they can't just type it up, man in arena quote, and find out who said it. And Alex said he found a book in their library that talked about all of the presidents. And so Gilbert said, oh, so that quote was in the book. And Alex said, no. And he figured out who said that quote because he read about each of the presidents and what they did in their presidency. And just based on what Theodore Roosevelt did during his presidency, he knew that that was his character and he had said that. And that's amazing to me because I have never met a high schooler who would work that hard to figure something out. And that's just really, really cool to me. So then at the end, when we were about to leave the high school, a group of guys came up and wanted to take a picture with me and Bella. So we said yes. We took a picture, and then Alex came over and hugged me. And he said, I want to give you something so you can remember me. And I was like, no, no, it's okay. But he was very insistent, so he gave me his pen. So now I have a pen to remember Alex. So that was a really cool experience. And then the last student is Mercy. And Mercy is 17, so she's my age. And she's Form 3, so a junior at the high school. And while we were on our trip, Bella and I got to do something pretty cool. When I Grow Up is making like a short documentary that's kind of like juxtaposing me and Bella's lives to two girls at the high school. So when we were at the high school, we got to sit down with two girls, Mercy and Mary, for about an hour and just talk and ask questions. And it was a lot of fun. It wasn't awkward at all. It was really fun. We were laughing a lot and smiling. And Mercy was just the brightest, most joyful, optimistic person I have ever met. She was super animated and energetic. And I just loved her. And at the end, we shared contact information and all that. But then after, when we got back to our hotel, I found out about Mercy's background, and it just shocked me because I would have never guessed where she came from based on how she acted. So when Mercy was in primary school, about seventh or eighth grade, she went to a friend's house in an apartment complex, and then she was walking home, and she got pulled into another room by some members of a gang, and she was sexually abused. Causing her to get over 2 months of medical attention and miss school for about 3 months. And seeing her and how optimistic she is, it was just incredible. And when we visited her mother, we asked if she had anything she'd like us to say to Mercy, and she said, tell her to just keep smiling, that I'm smiling for her. And so we asked Mercy about that and told her, and she said, when I was growing up, me and my mom would always just say this to each other. We'd say, just keep smiling when it gets bad, because if you don't smile, it can only get worse. And that's hard to do for me, is just to keep smiling when things get bad, because it's kind of hard to smile when things get bad. So Mercy was just really inspiring to me. And overall, just the kids at the high school, they were so strong and so smart, and they have such high aspirations for themselves. Like Mary, the other girl I talked to, she wants to become a lawyer for justice for children so she can help kids who are in her situation. And Mercy wants to start a music company in the UK. So it's just so cool meeting all of them and, you know, just forming these connections. That was what was most impactful for me and what I'm never gonna forget. So thank you, that was my story.
Okay, so for my presentation, I'm going to show you guys a video, and I hope to show you guys some of the joy and happiness that Lakin was talking about, and some of the background to what Furaha is about, because when I was there, I experienced tons of new experiences and things that I would have never imagined would actually be real, and it changed me for sure, and I really want to help those kids at Furaha, and being able to see the high schoolers really was on a new level, because it's like us here as high schoolers going over there and seeing what those kids are about. They just work so much harder, dedicate their entire lives to education, and so I hope that you guys can see what Furaha is about and kind of a day in the life of our Furaha student through my videos. Hope you enjoy. there's a poem on here that they're going to sing.
Your love is bright as ever, even in the shadows. Baby, kiss me before they turn the lights out. Your heart is glowing, and I'm crashing into you. Baby, kiss me, before they turn the lights out, before they turn the lights out. Oh, baby, love me lights out, in the darkest night I search through the crowd. Your face is all that I see. Giving you everything, baby, love me lights out. Baby, love me lights out. We don't have forever. Baby, daylight's wasting.
Thank you.
help me out here. I'm alone with what sure ain't clear. Cause every day I climb a mountain half the size than everyone else out there. And I know I'm ungrateful. I got sunshine, plenty of days full, but I don't mind a cloud and a confrontation now. Which might be what I'm asking for. A silhouette from which to run, and an absence from the fun I don't work hard enough for. But I'll be alright, yeah. Or maybe I'll just be a man or an individual. The lucky guy I am. Hey brother, said listen Jesus, I've been needing a word between us. The queen of the rifle, the king's name. She got my baby.
Stephen Corley. I think for me, the home visits were the most telling, because you see the joy that Lakin and Bella talked about, the exuberance, the thirst for learning, the desire to be at school. It's all real, and it's all there, and it's all set in a context that is so hard for us to sympathize or empathize with. We did different home visits than the girls did. We did 8. And any one story would break your heart. A mother who loses her husband to a car accident and is raising 2 children on her own in a shanty apartment down by the river that costs $17 a month. That's how much a terrible living condition costs. When we were decorating this, we couldn't make it look shabby enough, because we don't have that stuff just lying around here. But my guess is that for all of you that, for example, don't park cars in your garage because you've got stuff in your garage, you've got 10 times as much as they have. And you could probably make a nicer home than they can make. There's a woman who essentially, her teenage daughter died of heartbreak. Came home and the child's just on the bed. No obvious attack or suicide or something like that. Just literally heartbreak. They have a name for it in Swahili, which I can't think of. And then there was a woman who was in an accident, and she basically had a dislocated back, a broken back. And so she was homebound. And she was doing her best to take care of her 2 children. And there's 600,000 people of you heard that live in Huruma, which is an area about 2 square miles. So picture 4 times the population of Napa County, all living in Browns Valley. And any one of these people you would want to save, for lack of another word, from a Western perspective. Just in their circumstance, but they have those same heartbreaks that we have. They just have it in a different context. Those are three stories for one woman named Margaret. She lost her husband. Her daughter died of heartbreak a year later. And then she broke her back in an accident. And she's taking care of her two kids, fortunate enough to go to Furaha. And she gets up every day with hope in her heart because of the opportunity that her kids have to go to Furaha and that they get to eat for 25 cents that day from the food program that we support, that you guys support. 50 cents feeds her two kids that day, and it may be the only meal that they get. And it makes a huge difference, not for the kids to survive, but for the kids to thrive, because those are the kids that you saw in that video. They're happy kids. They're excited to go to school. And they have hope, and we help give it to them. Gilbert created the school, Pete and Crosswalk with the food program, and it's just extraordinary what they're doing with the opportunity, how grateful they are for it. This woman, Margaret, this is her home, this is her kitchen, this is her living room, this is her dining room, and this is her factory where she makes soap. In terms of the community working together, she's homebound. So when a neighbor is going to the market, which is outside of the slum, she gives them a little money and they buy the raw ingredients and bring it back to her, and she gives them some sort of little token of appreciation, and then she makes her soaps. And the neighbors that live on the little, it's not a street, it's really an open sewer, they sell the soap for her and give her the money, and she thanks them with a small token. And she gets up in pain every day, literally a broken body, and brokenhearted about her husband and her daughter, but not with a broken spirit. And the hope, and I'm going to come back to that, that she has every day is extraordinary. And we are a part of that. You are a part of that. And so you've gone and been Jesus. And we get to keep doing this. And Pete talks about it to us. We get this opportunity. And it's awesome. And I'm thankful to Crosswalk, to all of you, because that joy we got to experience firsthand. And it was awesome. Completely awesome to see. Any tears that I shed were really tears of joy. Tears of inspiration for what it is that we're doing over there. 120,000 meals so that these kids can thrive and not just survive. It's not the videos that I saw growing up on whatever channel of desperate folks in Africa or in third world countries, and you're just trying to get them to feed to get through the day. I mean, that's great. But these kids are aspiring to be doctors and lawyers and surgeons and see justice done, and they want to help their community. And it's just extraordinary. The only story we could think of was Mercy, that wanted to actually, she didn't want to escape from Furaha. She wanted to pursue her music career in Europe and the UK. But everybody else was interested in helping those around them, truly helping. And these people have nothing compared, well, they just have nothing, frankly. But they've got their smiles, and they've got their heart, and they've got hope. And that's really all they need. And when you walk around town, when you see some of Bella's shots, I mean, the circumstances are what we would consider dire. But their clothes are clean. They're proud to go out and try and make their money for the day, pay their bills, be a family, have the kids go to school. And they are so aware of the lottery ticket that they've won by having their kids in Furaha, and what an opportunity that is to for them to lead their way out of it. And they just love it. They absorb it. And from the little kids to the high school kids, every one of them is happy to be there. There's no false smiles. They may be smiling to help get through the day, but we all should. That was one of the eight stories. It was all just in that one person, Margaret. There was another gal, Beatrice. Beatrice lived in the building that collapsed, that Pete told us about, when it collapsed in March. She was fortunate enough to be on her balcony, and the building effectively collapsed away from her, and she survived with a smashed leg. We got a chance to visit her. She, in some ways, had the cleanest home because it had almost nothing in it. A bed, a chair. The chairs that we sat in were brought by the school, folding chairs. A bed, a chair, a calendar, a 5-gallon bucket for water, some knickknacks, and her sister to take care of her. This is a woman whose family died on the other side of the fallen walls of the building. And Furaha Community Center was taking care of her. She's no longer a parent, but she was a parent, but she's part of the community. And just like with the micro-lending, Furaha's extremely, the team that's there is interested in the whole community. So they're, Josephine is still going to check on Beatrice, make sure she gets to the major hospital when she needs to go. Transportation's not easy, it's not affordable, but they're taking care of Beatrice. And Beatrice literally had nothing. I think everything was that she had been given to her, and her sister was taking care of her. It's really hard to put in perspective the idea that there's a group of people even less fortunate than these that I've described. We went to visit two safe houses, one for boys, one for girls, for students, 7 boys and 7 girls, that have circumstances where they can't be in their own home. Either they don't have a home, or there's something wrong with the guardian, it's unsafe. And so you hear some stories about them and their circumstances that led them to need to be taken away from this, because this this situation is unsafe for them. And then to find out that there's 20 kids on a waiting list to get into the safe houses, but they don't have the resources for the safe houses. But when that really struck me, that there's 20 kids that go to Furaha that are in a circumstance that they shouldn't be in, when from our perspective, none of the 600,000 people should be in their circumstance. We would want to, quote unquote, save them all. So the fact that these 20 kids are at risk really struck me, and it's something that we're going to work with Gilbert on to see what we can do about it. It's not an easy situation to solve. So those are some pretty dire pictures of what's happening. And yet, I want to take you back to the singing and the dancing and the smiles, and that Mercy and Mary are just two high school girls like Bella and Lakin, and they have dreams and they want to do things and they want to go places. And it's just so awesome, so inspiring to see. And I want you guys to be proud of what we're doing here, making a difference, really making a difference. Furaha talks about taking care of 7,000 people. That's what they use as the number for the people that they impact. So that's going to be all the members, all the families at the school and the high school. That's going to be the micro-lending that they do. That's going to be the Beatrices that are just part of their larger family. That's going to be the, I think there's 43 members of staff. And the 43 teachers and members of the staff, they're only a couple of steps away from all of this. I don't think they live in Huruma, maybe one or two do on a temporary basis, but they live just outside of this neighborhood. They're not that far away, and they're from Huruma. They've managed to get themselves out, whether it was Huruma or Mathari, the other slum across the Nairobi River, which is really a sewer. And they're giving back, and they just are so giving of themselves. You think of those neighbors that are helping Margaret out. They don't have anything. They've got enough trouble to go to the market and get their own stuff, let alone helping take care of Margaret and selling soap for her and returning the money. When they don't have any money themselves, they could just sell the soap and be a bad neighbor and keep the cash. But that's not how this community is working. So it's really, really inspiring to see all of that. And to know that we're making a difference. We are bringing it, and it's awesome to see. I'll say that 1,000 times. It was a fantastic experience, and it was awesome, and it was inspiring, and we can do some more. And we'll try to do that as Crosswalk together, because there's always need for more food. There's weekend feeding that can be done. There are meals that actually go home. Josephine, when she does her home visits, she determines maybe when a family needs a little extra meal, so they'll actually send a meal home with the students at the end of the day. That can be expanded, because every family could use another 500 meals that night. 550 kids in the school, plus their brothers and sisters. There's a lot that can be done just on the feeding side of things and the shelter side of things. And these resources that we give are fantastic, but it's really coming back to the hope and the love that they feel and how these kids can thrive and not just survive that I would want you to have is a takeaway. We're not just keeping their heads above water, we're really providing an opportunity for them to improve their family situation and their community, and these kids want it. And it's going to be fantastic, because as the years go by, they're going to have more and more graduates, and Kenya is going to be better for it, and the world's going to be better for it. Love your neighbor. And we have neighbors here that we take care of. We have neighbors south of the border that we take care of, and we have neighbors in Africa that we take care of. And that's great. I would encourage anybody that wants to go to absolutely go and see what we're doing. It doesn't have to be Africa. It could be our other mission work. It can be right here, because it's fantastic. And your heart will grow. And we'd love to see the world be a better place. So go and get inspired and make a difference and be proud of the difference that you are making. Pete? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Unless you guys want to look at the backside of me, you're welcome to hang out. Let's thank them one more time for their report. Awesome. So maybe you're starting to connect some dots. How in the world do these people, how are they able to sing with such passion, genuinely? How excellent is your name, O Lord? I think, you know, if you and I were thrust into Huruma, I don't think we'd be singing any songs for a while. Songs of lament. But I don't know that we'd be singing songs of praise to God. I think we'd be maybe uttering, God, get me the hell out of here. But I don't think we'd be singing, how excellent is your name? Because we would feel abandoned. And we would feel like we're in the toilet. And we have no hope, because we would very quickly realize that the system in the slum of Huruma, with the corruption that surrounds it, is a system that intends to keep us there, if we're there together. But I think after a while, for some of us it might only take a year. For others of us it might take a decade or a lifetime. But I think in time, I think we would start to learn what they know that we don't. I think when you're in that environment for that long, when that's your reality, when you look around, I think there is a very, very slim possibility that you can look at yourself and your accomplishments and your stuff and just say, I have nailed it. I am on top of the world. I am kingdom of the castle. I am God. I have no need for God because I've arrived. I don't think that's highly probable when you're in that setting. I think when you're in that setting, I think you come to grips with a reality very quickly. A reality that we discover at Christmas time when we watch It's a Wonderful Life, and at times of death when we say goodbye to the loved ones that we are saying goodbye to. And that is this, that truly when we die, when we're done, we're all the same. We come into this world naked, and we leave the same. All the accoutrements, all the stuff, at the end of the day, is just stuff. And I think because of where they live, because of the circumstances that they're in, they have not been duped, like you and I, to think more of themselves because of how much they've acquired. And I think they are unbelievably, acutely aware that their ground of being, who they are, their source of life, their source of hope, is God and is God alone. I think that's why when you see these kids sharing with each other, loving each other so much, and giving themselves away to each other, it's because they know that nothing they have really is theirs to begin with. And when you go to the high school and you see this kind of community, which is dumbfounding to us because you don't see this selfishness, you know what happens when one of them wins a prize, be it a soccer jersey or the fleece? We saw it right before our eyes. The first thing that happened when this kid came back with Stephen's fleece is he gave it to the other kids so they could hang out with it. When one of them got a soccer jersey, the kid who won it wore it for 5 minutes. And then every other kid who wanted to wear the soccer jersey got to wear it for as long as they wanted. Why is that reality? Because they realize that the stuff that we value so much really isn't the stuff of life. And what they have discovered in their extreme poverty is that God actually shows up and comes alongside. They're not asking the question, God, where are you in the slum? Because they already know God is there with them. They experience it every day. Why do they sing, How Excellent Is Your Name, O Lord? Because they're living it every day. They're saying, God, you got me through yesterday. You're going to get me through today. You're going to get me through tomorrow. How excellent is your name, O Lord? Because you show up even here. That's awesome. That's something we struggle to realize. Because we're duped. I think with our comfort. I think with our self-importance. I think with our stuff. Which brings me to an incredibly cheesy country song. So we're out of the high school, and one of the things that, you know, we learned, and I kind of figured this out, but they kind of said it out loud this trip, is when we're there, it's kind of like a field day for the kids. They get the day off. They might, in the high school, they might be in class for the morning, you know, while we're traveling out there. But then the afternoon, it's blow-off time. So what do they love to do? They love to sing and dance. And the dances you saw, cultural dances largely, they love it. I'm a terrible dancer, but I kind of like it. As long as nobody's watching and my wife's not there having to be embarrassed by me, it's cool. Well, they love it too, and they love to sing, and it's part of their culture, it's part of their fabric. You're not going to go very long before they're moving and dancing some way or other. It's very, very cool. Most of the dances you saw, by the way, the ones that are winning the national award and all that stuff, those are like traditional wedding dances that you would do together, you know, with lots of people. So they know these dances. So anyway, we're at the high school, and they're doing the dances, and they're doing some praise songs and saying some poems. And then a couple, three girls get up and they cue the music, And it's a country song in the background, and they're singing along with this country song, which I know is from America. I know it's from America because I looked it up. And I'm just here to tell you, I know some of you folks like country music, and I'm not trying to make fun of you in any way, really. Well, maybe a little bit. But anyway, this song is something 10 years old or so. And let me make sure I get the name of the song right. And I actually gave you a link in my blog, which we'll release this afternoon. And it's called Thank You, Lord, for Your Blessings on Me by the Easter Couple. That's as much as I know about the artist. And I've listened to it. This thing in America has received literally millions of hits. In other words, it's resonated with people in the United States. And the chorus of which, and by the way, I'm just warning you, because this song has all the simple elements of a classic country song. Nothing complicated about it at all. And as I'm listening to it, I'm thinking, who soiled these girls' repertoire with a song like this? And when you watch the video, you're going to see people who look a lot like us, who are wearing nice clothes in a nice environment. And I think we can understand the sentiment of what they say, but this is the chorus. There's a roof up above me, roof up above me. I have a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. And when I heard the song first, I couldn't get the schmaltiness of the song out of my head. I'm like, there's not enough wine in Napa Valley to go with this much cheese. You know, that's kind of what I was thinking. But then the second time, when they started singing the second verse, I started looking at the face of the girls who were singing this, high school girls, same age as my daughter. Knowing Mercy's story, Mercy who grew up in a toilet called Huruma, Mercy who fought illness, who earlier this year was brutally raped, 2 months to recover. And yet there she stands and sings. And when a girl has been through that, is singing, there's a roof up above me. I have a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I just about lost it. Because if we sing that chorus, we sing it as a hypothetical. But when they sing it, it's their testimony. You, God, have delivered. Even Mercy, who has every reason to scorn the earth and die, is not dying, is thriving. Is not rejecting God, but rejoicing that God has been with her. Blows my mind. That's why they sing, how excellent is your name, O Lord. How beautiful is your name, O Lord. How powerful is your name, O Lord. Because God shows up in spite of it all and is truly there. So you have communion before you. Chapatis, which is sort of like a flat bread. Very similar to what they have. And there's a cup in the middle. This is open communion. You're welcome to try it. And if you've never had communion, you're certainly welcome to give it a shot. At the end of the day, communion, you know, in one facet is Jesus' element that he gave us to just say one clear word. That God is with us. And that God loves us. And that God is graceful. That you may have misgivings about what's going on, and maybe today's altered your reality a little bit. Maybe you're thinking about life differently. Maybe you feel inspired. Maybe you feel guilty. I don't know what, but this is what communion means, is that God loves you, and God's with you. And as God has been with them, so God wants to be with you powerfully. And so as we take the bread in a moment, and there's plenty for you to probably even have seconds, and you dip it in the cup and eat it. This is a shared communion, because communion means it's not something we do on our own, but we do with others. We do it together here to say we're in this together. We've heard this good news together. We do it with God who is present here with us. But because it's Chapati, we do it with our Kenyan brothers and sisters. And we say right along with them, we hear that God is good news. And we're in this together. And we will sing with you. How excellent is your name, O Lord. So I invite you to sing with me. A couple of refrains. It's really easy to remember. You can't screw it up too bad. And then I'll instruct you when it's time to take some communion. And then we'll be done. So sing with me. How name, O Lord, how excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name, how excellent is your name, how excellent is your name, O Lord. How excellent is your name, how excellent is your name, how excellent is your name, O Lord. I want you to picture Mercy's face. I want you to picture these children's faces. I want you to think about the power of God breaking into them. And I want you to sing with me, how beautiful is your name, O God, O Lord. How beautiful is your name, O Lord. How beautiful is your name, O Lord. How beautiful is your name, how beautiful is your name, how beautiful is your name, O Lord. How beautiful is your name, how beautiful is your name, how beautiful is your name, O Lord. Now I want you to think about the reality of that slum. Pictures are up there. Think about that being your daily routine and realizing that God breaks in and God breaks through even that. To come close to our brothers and sisters there, to say to them loud and clear, I love you. I am with you now. I am with you always. God is that powerful. And God is that powerful for you and for me. So let's sing it together. How powerful is your name, O Lord. How powerful is your name, O Lord. How powerful is your name, how powerful is your name, how powerful is your name, O Lord. How powerful is your name, how powerful is your name, how powerful is your name, O Lord. Powerful enough. Take and eat communion together. Join me in prayer. This is the bread that they eat. God, this is the bread that our instructors eat. Our instructors on what it is to do life hand in hand with you. how to find joy in spite of circumstances. They are our instructors. They are our mentors. They are ones who have discovered grace in ways that we have yet to find. God, we thank you for them. We thank you for how they teach us. We thank you how they model for us. We thank you that we have the great privilege of doing anything for them. God, keep them in our memory. As we go through our day, as we're tempted to complain, as we're tempted to be selfish, as we're tempted to be greedy, as we're tempted to whine about what we don't have, remind us of our brothers and sisters who teach us that you are all we need. That you, at the end of the day, are everything we need. May that one great truth inspire us to live differently. May we look at our stuff and no longer call it our stuff, but call it your resources to use. May we look at our lives and no longer consider it our life alone, but our life to use for something greater than ourselves, for a cause bigger than ourselves, for more than fattening up our portfolios or filling our garages. May we learn the lesson, God, from our teachers in the slum of Huruma, that you are life, you are our source. We commune with them today as we commune together and with you. Change us, inspire us, humble us, empower us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So before you go today, we're going to roll the video once again that came on while you were here, just coming into the service. Sights and sounds of the kids having a great time and singing and all that. But on your tables, there's a little pledge card kind of a thing. I think they're there. And it's an invitation for you. Maybe today inspired you, and you're like, I got to get on board with this thing, because it really is changing the trajectory of an entire community. And so maybe you're even a visitor to Crosswalk. You don't know anything about us, but you want to get on board. And maybe today you make a one-time gift. So check the box and put that in with your offering and help us out, help them out. We're also asking you Crosswalkers that have already stepped up to, you know, our monthly giving thing. We're asking you to up that from $30 to $36. $6, that's all we're asking. Just asking you to up that. So today when I get home, I'm going to go on my banking thing and set my new amount that gets cut to Crosswalk for that account, an extra $6. And we're asking you to do that because an extra $6 to you and me, that's a fancy drink at Starbucks, right? But together, collectively, huge difference. So instead of the $30 a month for 360, we're just asking it up at $36. No big deal, but it's a big deal to them. And it's a big deal for all the missions that we deal with here. Our food pantry right here at Crosswalk. All the things that we touch. And then if you've never gotten on board with this idea of regular giving, why not start with that? Because most of us here today can swing $36 a month. And you're going to make a huge difference here locally to people who are in need. You're going to make a difference in California. You're going to make a difference in Tijuana, Mexico. And you know you're making a difference in Africa. So today's a day to step up. And of course, you know, your regular offerings that you do to help our church, those keep the whole thing moving forward. And we need your support, and we thank you for your support. Asante in Swahili means thank you for being Jesus. I say to you, Asante. Asante San, which means thank you very much. Asante San for being Jesus. You are awesome. You are awesome. Let's continue to be awesome and see what God can do with us. Are you with me on that? All right. Let's give God a thanksgiving of praise. And the ushers are coming around. And as the ushers come around, would you give us our last slide? And once the ushers are kind of done with their thing, if you can give us some volume on that. Jason, then we welcome you to leave. Thanks for being here today. Hope to see you next week.